This is Ram. Ram is a sysadmin that really loves technology. On his spare time, he loves to hack Solaris, and he's working in his own distribution. He is now going to tell us everything we need to know about containers, which is perfect since we've been talking about Docker recently. This is a talk I've personally been looking forward to quite a lot, because a big play in the container space I've heard about is Tupperware, and I would love to hear what they're up to. Let's give a big hand to Ram.
Thanks, Bjorn. So hi, I'm Ram. I work with a company called ThoughtWorks. I've been fortunate to play a variety of roles. I've assembled and sold computers. I've been a sysad. I've been a dev. I've enjoyed build and release engineering. And I'm currently trying to revive an operating system which a friend of mine had put together many years ago. That's what Bjorn was talking about. So we're going to cover the topic of containers, right? And we just had a discussion on Docker. So roughly, this is what we'll be covering. And let me tell you this. While I was putting together all these slides and while I was figuring out, I realized somehow 30 minutes is not enough. So I'm going to cover what you will ordinarily not find outside, what's not going to be blogged about or not written. These are things that you learn the hard way, right? Okay. Now, this is what people usually use containers for. We just heard the other speaker talk about how they just bundle everything together, deploy it on one server, and it gives them some sort of portability. That's good, right? So you are able to take one set of packages all the way from dev to prod, right? For a lot of people, it also means you no longer have to listen to sysads and all of it, which I kind of understand. I worked in environments where people hold on to the servers. You know, they don't let you change stuff. They want to know each and everything that goes in. Yes, they have their reasons, but it can get very unrealistic. So people have swung the other way and said, you know what, I don't care. I just need you to run this Docker D. I'm going to push my files there. It runs. That's it. Leave me alone. But this is what people actually end up doing, right? People end up treating a container. Docker is not the only one. There are quite a few in the Linux space itself. People end up treating containers as virtual machines, right? They end up thinking that, hey, I'll just take all this. I'll just put it all there, and I should be fine. But no. Because of a lot of implementation details, you will be surprised at finding that someone's just broken into your box. You'll be fine. You'll wonder that, why is my disk IO so slow all of a sudden? You'll be wondering, hey, why are my deployment artifacts so much larger, right? They were not so much larger before, or why is there so much of merging issues that I'm facing now, right? And the usual thing that, as a sysad, I've often had to face when people call me and say, the app doesn't work in your prod environment. You know, it was all working fine on my laptop, right? So that usually does happen, right? Here are some other questions that come up whenever, you know, you hear, there's just a lot happening in this space. Just this very week, there were around three different announcements in the areas of networking, in some security issues also, and some new random Docker sockets being exposed, and anyone with access can just break in. So it's all just crazy. And some of my clients actually asked, hey, Ram, what did we do before Docker? Weren't things just fine? So yes, it is possible to do stuff without Docker or containers or anything. FYI, I'm one of the team who deploys stuff to gcloud. We deploy about once a week. We have an environment of 17 virtual machines. Our entire deployment is one click, and we deploy in around 2 minutes. 2 minute 20 odd seconds. That's our time. So yes, we did have life before Docker and before containers. It's just that one needs to understand why you really wanted to use it, right? So just so that we all get on the same page, this is, okay, I'll be giving out the slides for just about every image that I have out there. I've got links at the bottom which point to the real articles. Please do read these. These are very well-written articles, almost all of these, I would say. So this is the kind of diagram that's given to end users. This is not how virtual machines actually work, but this is the best kind of thing you can do for an end user so that they can understand, oh, I've got a virtual machine, right? But depending upon the implementation, it's either one or the other, right? And this is how VMs work. I've given here a diagram of operating system containers. This is not a Docker container thing. This is a regular operating system container thing. And zones and jails typically work this way. You could argue that Linux containers actually work somewhat like this. We'll see later on how there are differences, right? This is actually the promise of containers, that normally you would have had regular processes, and now you have your processes wrapped around in a container. You know, it's there's something that's isolating it from the rest of the world. It does not see the rest of the world. The rest of the world does not see it, except via ports that you specify and so on, right? This is what the story has been on Linux. There was LXC. There are enough articles out there which talk about how Docker used LXC earlier, and then they went on to do their own things. They came up with libcontainer, and it makes the right API calls and all of that stuff. Just 1 minute. Ubuntu, the Canonical folks have come out with LXD, which they're positioning not as a competition to Docker, but as something that will play along with it. Let's see how that works out. Right, this is the official picture from the Docker website, right? Saying that, hey, we got a Docker engine, just give us your image format file and we'll make all the right C groups and namespace calls and all of it, and we'll spin up your app for you. They actually do that, right? Now, here's what happens. When you go live, there are, I'll just briefly touch on some security stuff here. For various reasons, a lot of people do recommend that you run just one container instance on a VM in prod. You do not make it a multi-tenant host running different containers, right? There are a bunch of reasons. Let's debate those later if you don't mind, right? If you see on the other side, we talk about how an application runs directly on the host. That's what containers are supposed to be. And you see over here that this is what happens in the virtual machine space. But you know what? Practically what happens is when you use just about anyone's container infrastructure out there, they actually end up running the Docker daemon and C groups and everything all in the same call stack. So where we have over here application, you would actually have something else that goes on over there. It's the right kind of API calls fired to the Linux kernel. We'll just see that in the slide next. I'll just show you. Have you heard of something called Bokker? This made the news a few months ago. It was pretty nicely discussed on Hacker News. So if you see this, the text in bold, that is all that really happens. Yes. So there's one guy who came up with something called Bokker, and 100 lines of the whole shell script is 100 lines, and these are the essential parts of those 100 lines, where he makes all the right API calls, he calls C groups calls chroot, and it runs the app. This is what Bokker does. This is what just about everyone else in a Linux space needs to do. Wow. Yes. What Bokker? Yeah. So what do all these other tooling then do then? What they do is they make it all easy to use. Something like this will not immediately talk about file formats, right? A lot of the people who do a lot of their own value add, they talk about those things, right? So that's it. Now, so what really happens is if you see this, there's a C groups call that's being made. C groups is a Linux a thing where you have a container grouping and you can set resource groups together and say how much CPU, how much RAM should go for this set and so on. So what really happens is where I have set application, that's actually the C groups call being made. So when you say, hey, I'm not using virtual machines, I'm going to run Docker, a lot of the professional container hosters out there who give you Linux based hosting, they actually run a standard Linux VM. They accept your Docker package, put it over there, fire the API call, and your call stack is still this. This is what's the reality. This is with regular Linux-based deployments, right? How do containers on other environments work then? So there's FreeBSD. They've had jails for very many years, right? And there are companies like IX Systems who have a living on this. You have some comments? All right, okay. FreeBSD was one of the first with jails, right? Then you have Sun Solaris, which is now Oracle Solaris. You have Illumos, which is a fork of the Open Solaris code base. I was one of the devs on one of the distros, which became Solaris 11. And that has had this for a lot many years. And these are the kind of things that you get. I'll give you a small showcase on zones. That's part of our demos. We'll compare regular containers on Linux versus zones as an example, right? These are the kind of things that you get. I'm talking here about something called exclusive kernel objects. This is important because, let's just jump ahead. In this diagram, when we talk about zones, I don't get a cursor. All right, fine. You have this layer over here called the host kernel. So when you run Solaris zones, or when you run Illumos zones, or when you use SmartOS from Joint, what these folks give you is they give you dedicated kernel objects which are dedicated exactly to your application. So if there is a particular code path that, let's say, has a contention issue or some such technical thing that, you know, some other code flow by another process could hit that and encounter problem, let's just say. Over here, you have dedicated objects, right? And that's one of those things. The other things are you can also have exclusive TCP stacks. Now, there's a whole separate movement nowadays with, you know, things like the DLPK project and so many other such. There's an Italian university, I forgot their name. There are people who now give you your own TCP stacks. So you no longer depend on the operating system for its TCP stack because that's just too slow, and you just end up using these libraries and have your own TCP stack because it makes it so much faster. So you can also choose to have exclusive TCP stacks for your applications. You have facilities like this. Now, because the Linux API has, you know, there is some kind of stabilization now, it is now possible to implement the same syscalls in a different operating system, such that you can take a Linux ELF binary, place it over there, it just does its work, and the right syscalls, as long as they are correctly emulated, your app just works. So some of the upcoming things, there's going to be some collaboration between Illumos and the FreeBSD folks, is to take this kind of syscall execution and just make it work around. Why is all this important to our sort of a crowd? You know, we all just use Macs and we use Docker and we deploy apps and all of it. The reality is we are all just users of Bash. We just use Bash, we just use Vim, we just use whatever other userland tools, we use our tech stacks. We don't actually care anymore what happens below the covers. So now is actually more than a time that there are all these other alternatives that one could start looking at, right? Okay, I just covered Bokker. All right, folks. Okay, is this pace fine? Any feedback for me? Do I go slower or is it, you know, am I assuming a lot of insider knowledge? All right, fine. Thank you. Right. Okay. This is all the competition in this space. Just you name the organization and they try to say, yes, we are your saviors in the Docker space. You know, run containers with us. We'll make it all work well for you. Thank you, Bjorn, for telling me I have just 10 minutes remaining, right? So there's a lot of confusion, actually, because everyone tries to say that, you know, just use my tooling. Some of my ex-colleagues who work at places like Netflix, their minds are just at hundreds of thousands of VMs, you know. And when I talk to them about my application space where I have 20 or 40 VMs, they say, you know, my testbed is much hundreds of times larger than that. Well, so that's their reality. So because of a lot of this competition and conflicting messaging, there's also this project called Open Containers where people have come together. And they are all, they're busy contributing specifications. With this, there was a little bit of one-upmanship with, you know, CoreOS trying to do one thing and Docker guys going and saying, oh, we were open all the time. Here's our contribution. So there was some unfortunate stuff there, but with a lot more players and with the Linux Foundation trying to oversee it all, hopefully things are, you know, less confusing and less politicized over a period of time. So just to quickly clear out these things, if you do not have a large setup, don't worry and waste your time looking at things like Mesos, Kubernetes, what have you right now. They're all still undergoing a lot of change themselves. There's a lot of contribution. There's a lot of people trying to figure out what to do with it, right? But what you still do need to care about are these kind of topics. They don't go away, okay? For example, let's take a case. You try out, you got this smart new idea, you try out, you know, you just set up a local Docker setup. You just say, hey, I'm gonna take in Ubuntu and I'm gonna do a whole bunch of stuff with it. It looks good, you go share it with friends, it looks even better, and someone asks you to add some features. And you realize, you know, I need to make this small change over here. And you start making a change to that image. And you have all the right CI and whatnot. But after some time, when it all looks good and you wanna go live with it, is it fine to take that modified Ubuntu image and just give it to someone, right? The thing is, you have just modified what Ubuntu had released. Now, when you modify it, can you still, whom do you hold accountable? You have things like that to answer for. When someone breaks into your tech stack, you know, the earlier thing talked about Mezzanine and Nginx and all of it. Let's say someone discovers an exploit in Nginx and they breaks into this container of yours. Right, they've broken into the container, they've injected some libraries over there, and it's starting to serve stuff. Someone needs to get in and diagnose. How do you do it? Right, you need to have answers for things like that. You have stuff like someone says, you know, I think there's a modification here, I don't like it, stop this instance. You stop it. How are you going to verify that all the executables within that container are still intact? Right, there are a lot of these real world regular production issues and concerns that you have to have answers to. A regular container does not take it away. You still have to do a lot of due diligence, right? Beyond time check. Okay, fine. Okay, in the space of containers again, there's a lot, at least in the Linux space, there's still a lot of development and people are still learning as they go along. There are a bunch of network holes out there. We'll discuss those separately offline if you don't mind. And there are enough limitations, like you still have to use whatever Linux bridging can achieve. And if you're in one container, one VM sort of a setup, that's good. But if you have something more, let's say you have 2-3 containers of your own within one virtual machine, how do you exactly make them communicate, do rate limiting, do a lot of QoS and whatnot? It's not yet solved. So you have VMware who recently announced their VMware NSX, saying that, hey, we are going to support Docker. Actually, they have a whole lot of things worked out. I've used them about 2 years ago already, and they had solved a bunch of problems. But beyond that, it's not enough, because these, okay, I enjoy Solaris. I do a lot of the open source stuff with my distro, so you'll see me talk a lot about Solaris things as well. But this thing that you see at the bottom is what people are trying to get to, in the Linux side at least. With VMware, VMware have solved it. FreeBSD have some sort of an answer already. And this is what VMware is offering in the market, saying, we will help you achieve this on your Linux-based hosts. Wherein what they want you to be able to do is have a whole lot of software layer switching, where you should be able to design your entire networks. Imagine if the team at the DataGovSG, if they were able to create their entire default dev prod VLANs just on their local machine with the exact kind of isolation, right? How cool would that be? That's the kind of things that people actually want to be able to do. It's still work in progress, right? Yes, security issues. Now, especially with the kind of work that I've done recently and the kind of issues I've had to deal with in prod, I would say that it is wise to take security pretty seriously, okay? And one top reference for me has so far been the CIS benchmarks. There are also the NIST standards and a lot of other NSA standards and such things. But I would say that the CIS standards are good to get started with. Right, I've got some, this is some other reading. I'll be sharing the slide deck. You can see a lot of these links. I'd like to give you a quick demo. Okay. Here's a situation. Okay, is everyone able to see this? Why don't I just... Yeah. I move the text to the top of the screen. Is everyone able to read the... Is the font size good enough for you? Okay, thank you. Right. So here's a quick example where, you know, we see the time that it takes for this to spin up a container. That means to make all the right C groups calls and namespace settings and all of it. And use that particular library, set up the ch root, and then execute date within it. Good, actually. Right? And execute date within it. Right? Now, here at the site, I'll give you the same thing on SmartOS, which is based on Illumos, where when I had talked about zones. Here's what I'm doing. I've got a list of containers, and they are all named by UUIDs over here. And what we're going to do is we're going to boot it, and then we are going to log into it. So look at the time. Right? In this time, an entire first-class container was spun up. A huge bunch of services in it were started. All the right networking and all the plumbing was set up. Depending on what I would have configured, it could have either an exclusive TCP stack or its shared TCP stack with other containers. It is a multi-service setup, so I can get in and see a whole bunch of services. Right? And all of this got done in about half a second. So just to show it to you, again, I'll halt it. It's gonna take 2 seconds to halt. And we'll just log in again. That's it. So this is an open distro. It's called SmartOS. It's by Joanne, the Node.js folks. And they've got a whole bunch of stuff. Some of the things that they've done is they've taken KVM for Linux, ported it to the Illumos kernel. They run it inside a zone. So you can run Windows apps within this. You can take an Ubuntu distro and run it within this. They have also done all that syscall emulation thing that I had spoken of. So you can take a regular Linux binary, put it there, and run it. And at least those of you who have used Macs would be familiar with something called dtrace. Dtrace came from this world, so you have full dtrace support. You can actually take a Linux app, put it there, and from outside, you can just dtrace a Linux app. Imagine the power of that. That's actually a topic for a different day, but it's pretty intense. It's pretty deep, the kind of things you can do. All right, I'm done. Questions? Yes, please.
You mentioned several slides back, mm-hmm. the benefit to one thing to avoid being multi-container tenancy. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Can you expand on that a little?
Yes. So there are, depending upon which build of Docker daemon you run and, you know, whether the calls are right and all of it, if, as a hosting provider, I provide to you a host and say, hey, just give me a container, I'll run it for you, you should be asking me, are there other clients of mine whose containers also I run over there within the same VM?
Same VM. Okay.
Right? Because if there is a breakout from that VM and they get the whole box, they can get to you. And that's bad for you, actually. So,
yeah. Level,
yeah, you're right. Thanks for the feedback. I'll figure out something around that. Yeah. Okay. Feedback for me. How was this too technical? Did I cover too little or too much? The reason I'm asking is I plan to make a series of talks on these topics and a bunch of workshops, and I just wanted to understand how much deeper would you have liked me to go. Like, I could have shown some code and all of that also, just detraced the whole thing and shown it to you. Just thought I'll ask. Or do you think this was right for today?
Just right.
For me, yes.
Okay. Right. Others in the room? Did I say anything heretical?
Yeah.
All right. Yes. Okay. What was that?
I wouldn't agree with saying that you want to put a container within a VM, because I think that defeats the entire purpose of a container model. You want to have it as lightweight as possible, so I better declare I'm from Red Hat. So, the reason is very, not so much a Red Hat, but I better declare it anyway. It's got to do with the notion of a lightweight virtual machine is what we are trying to reach with the Docker model. It's not so much a VM itself, it's the application that is being made into a virtual, from a virtual perspective. So virtualized and lightweight application with all the necessary libraries wrapped around, and now you ship it across. So the ideal case, from my point of view, independent of Red Hat, is that I want to not have to have a VM, but have just enough of an operating system at a base, so that I can have as many containers, thousands of containers, and they are all separately secured up from with SE Linux wrapped around and taken care of. And that's really what a lot of work is going on right now. So that's what I would take exception.
Actually, where was that security? Please see this. I'm a Red Hat user, myself. And one of the things that I skipped on mentioning, thank you actually, is SE Linux and AppArmor. And my personal preference is SE Linux. It's not enough that you just take a VM, put in a container over there and say, hey, I'm done. That is actually not enough. The CIS benchmarks talk about a whole bunch of stuff. Plus, beyond that, Red Hat have done a lot of good work actually with SE Linux. So you'll have to use a lot of mechanisms like that to truly contain what you have over there. Now, actually, from what I do know, whether it's Amazon or Google, they do take your Docker images and they run those within VMs. They do not run it on bare metal. They cannot.
That is true from their perspective. But if you really want to do if you want to have an internal of your own private cloud, so to speak, what you want to do is not to have to worry about VMs, because when you have a VM, that essentially means you have a lot of other overheads. That's the whole objective behind a container. Strip out the stuff that you don't require, keep it as bare minimum just to support the app and be done with it and all the necessary ports open up, and that's it.
I'm with you on that. And actually, for me, that ties in with the kind of feedback I felt from his earlier question on this thing. Avoid multi-container tenancy when you have different organizations with the same hosting provider. But if it is your own organization, for example, let's say they would have had the CKN app and Mezzanine and Nginx and all of it, sure. Right?
You can still do that, because with the SE Linux model, as the I'm coming from that, because I've spent so much time trying to figure that one out for myself, that I find that once I have locked myself out of environments because of SE Linux policy, which is the right thing, which is great. You say, I got locked myself out, so damn it, what did I do wrong? Then I figured out, that's the policy, it's a policy thing, right? So it actually works so well that it can cause a problem.
Yes, I guess I'm with you on this point. It's all that I'm trying to say. So you see, there are so many of us who just take an app, dockerize it, and just say, hey, it's all dockerized, it's ready to deploy. The point I'm trying to make is that's not enough. And especially when you give these things to your clients and they go and take those apps and deploy them in God knows what cloud or multi-tenant setup, it's not going to be safe enough for them. And that's the thing. I shall change this. And thank you for the reminder. It's a time check. Thank you, folks. Bye. If you have any questions-